I'm Leah Rubin-Kedrain, head of creative for Arcadia, which is Snapchat's in-house branded AR creative studio. We have about 12 minutes together today, and I hope that by the end of that time, you all feel as inspired as I do about the power of AR to transform the way we experience the world. Before I get into it, does anyone out there have a toddler at home?
Yes.
Nice. You're a plant. But chances are you had a kid 2-3 years ago, right around 2022, as did I. And that happened to be the exact moment that AI started to explode. I was on maternity leave when I had my first chat with ChatGPT. I was holding my baby and nursing her when I found out from a Slack message on my phone that my team had started using Gen AI tools to bypass days, if not weeks, of design time. So in many ways, it felt like my baby and AI were littermates, like twins born together, entering the world, opening their eyes at the same time. And they were both in deep learning overdrive, this mode where every interaction they had with the world really mattered and could light up infinite new neural pathways. So I had a feeling that year that I don't think I'd have had before becoming a parent. And it was this feeling of wanting to protect AI. It was an urge to shield its young, impressionable mind from all the rotten inputs of the world and to feed it good, wholesome data and to give it positive, healthy role modeling, just like I wanted to do for my own kid. But before I had this kid, and shout out to my incredible wife who's in some of these photos and also here today, before we brought this kid home, AR, augmented reality, was really my first baby. I'd been working in the field a while, but it still felt like a new technology, one whose outer frontiers we were still exploring and discovering. And so I realized, in the same way that AI and my baby would be newborns together in the world, AI and AR would be growing up together too. And if we could bring them together, AR as this lens for seeing the world, and AI with its supercharged computing power, we could raise an extraordinary new generation of technology. For a lot of folks, this is what AR is. And this was baby AR. This is where it started. It was the puppy dog face. It was the vomiting rainbow. It was playful, simple, easy to use. But all that time we were all fooling around with these selfies, we were actually acquiring a new skill. We were learning that you can open your mouth and a tongue will pop out, that you can raise your eyebrows and your eyes will bug out, eventually that you could tilt your head left and right to make selections. We were learning how to navigate AR in the same way that anyone out there who's a non-digital native once had to learn how to navigate a website, that you can tap a hamburger menu, that you can click a hyperlink. We had to learn in these early days how to navigate AR. I've always loved this quote that toys are not really as innocent as they look. Toys and games are the precursors to serious ideas. It's a quote attributed to Charles Eames. I like to think it was his wife, Ray, who probably said it because he stole a lot of credit for her good ideas. But anyhow, in the same way that the ABCs song unlocks the building blocks of reading and writing and literacy, AR in those early days with those playful selfies was unlocking the building blocks of a much more serious idea. And that ambition, that goal, was always overlaying computing on the world around us, turning the camera around from the face to the world to change the way we experience everyday reality. Now, that might sound intense. It can be. That's where my team comes in. My team, Arcadia, is responsible for finding those really productive, useful, ultimately beneficial use cases for overlaying computing on the world around us. And we do this with brands and partners. We do this to solve problems for businesses, solve problems for consumers, and ultimately to solve problems for everyday humans. Humans really are at the heart of augmented reality. I had the thought recently that, all right, AI and AR both start with A. In the case of AI, of course, stands for artificial, meaning something other than real, something replacing reality. Whereas in the case of AR, the A stands for augmented. AR cannot run without reality. It depends upon reality. It can't run on its own. It can't replace reality. It depends on this grounded true layer of reality to operate on top of. And when you do apply computing on top of that layer of reality, it can be really useful, like a sign language tutorial that's tracked to your hands. Or it can be imaginative. It can help you dream up new outfits and looks every day. And it can just be playful. It can connect you with friends and make you laugh together. You can imagine how AR might get to a whole new level when we free ourselves from the phone screen and start wearing AR devices on our faces or AR glasses. Imagine being able to play with Lego bricks in AR anytime, anywhere, with your hands free to maneuver really naturally and intuitively with the real world. Imagine using your voice to call up a new Lego brick of any shape, color, size, whatever you want to build with, and imagine tracking your build onto a real table surface right there in your living room. This is actually an AR experience my team built and just launched in AR Spectacles 2 days ago at the annual Snap Partner Summit. So, what happens when you bring AI into this mix? Suddenly, this layer of computing that we've overlaid on the world around us gets a whole lot smarter. For me, there are two ways in which AI can really unlock AR. And the first is through making our cameras smarter, teaching our cameras to perceive the world with the same intelligence as the human eye does. And the second is Gen AI, using Gen AI to instantly create AR content on the fly. So let's start by talking that first way in, AI making our cameras smarter. AI can look at a plant and tell you what kind of plant it is. It can look at your dog and tell you what breed of dog you've got. It can even recognize entire cityscapes, brick by brick with pixel precision, so that we can overlay layers of play, utility, creativity on top of entire city blocks. Those are all real applications that run on Snapchat. I'll tell you now about a project I worked on with Disney that used this technology in an interesting way. Disney was celebrating its 100-year anniversary, and they came to us asking for some help. They were building an interactive pop-up exhibit that would travel from city to city, and they wanted it to feel really immersive. So they asked us, how might AR make this event experience more dynamic for guests? Together, we decided to embed AR into every room of the exhibit so that as guests passed through using their phones, they could step even deeper into the magical world of Disney. But in order to integrate AR really seamlessly into this event space, we had to give the camera a really deep understanding of the room, of the space that it would live in. And to do that, we used a technology called custom location mesh, which scans the surfaces of a room and instantly creates a 3D digital mesh scan that your AR elements then sit on top of and track to. But using this technology proved really challenging in a live event environment where not only would there be constant foot traffic and obstructions, but also the layout of the event space in each city was completely different. And not only that, but the event spaces wouldn't be constructed until a couple days before the events opened. So what we did was we started by preparing all of our 3D objects, animations, and code based on an approximation of the space. And then the moment the space was constructed in each city, we swooped in and captured those 3D digital mesh scans. So we could then reorient all of the AR elements more precisely. So as guests passed through, the AR really seemed to match and enhance the physical environment. The result was a really breathtaking live AR experience where flowers bloomed up from the ground beneath your feet as you walked, flying rocking horse flew down from the ceiling and circled around you, characters burst out from the walls and beckoned guests onward and further and deeper into these really magical Disney scenes. Okay, so we've talked about AI making AR smarter and making the camera smarter. Let's talk now about that second way in. I'm sure most of us in this room have played around with some Gen AI tools like Midjourney, DALL-E, some heads nodding. What if we could apply those same principles to actually creating dynamic AR 3D content in the camera on the fly? Well, my team's been experimenting with this technology. This is an early internal test we did where we taught the camera to recognize any object and make an instant copy of it, but not just a 2D static copy, a fully realized 3D replica. So essentially, any object you hold up becomes a fully to scale model of itself that you can then send to a friend that they can hold in their own hands so that they can really experience in an embodied way exactly what it is that you are seeing and experiencing in the moment. How about this use case? What if you could speak any word into existence? What if you could say fish and create a 3D fish right there in the room with you that you could walk around from 360 degrees and inspect from every angle? Let's take it a step further. What if you could affect the way that fish looked? What if you could affect its design, its treatment, its textures? In this case, we trained an AI model on the texture of building blocks so that you'd say the word butterfly, and before you would appear a 3D butterfly in the room with you made of building blocks. Imagine what you might do with that technology. Okay, and now imagine turning that technology around to our faces. About a year ago, we launched a project called NYX Beauty Bestie with the L'Oreal brand NYX, which served up daily makeup inspiration. The way we built this was we worked with a team of professional makeup artists to design original looks that they then photographed and that we then painstakingly recreated in AR. So then we could serve these looks up to users based on their tastes, tailored just to them, based on their mood in the moment, the weather in their city that day, their color preferences. And the more you used NYX Beauty Bestie, the better it got. The better it got at serving up the perfect look for you at the perfect moment. It was really a hit. It quickly had 91.6 million users. 84% of those users were coming back multiple times, which meant to us that this product was becoming part of their daily habit, part of their morning beauty routine. And at the same time as this was taking off, so was AI. So I had the thought, what if instead of working from these 2D images of makeup looks designed by makeup professionals and then hand creating AR to match them, what if we could train AI to do that work for us? What if AI could learn to generate AR makeup looks and not only match those pro quality designs it was trained on, because we've turned this set of makeup looks now into a data set, a training set, but what if it could also learn to riff and learn to imagine new variations on these makeup looks? Well, we did it. We announced the launch 2 days ago of a Gen AI powered version of NYX Beauty Bestie that can design and create AR makeup looks just for you on the spot. And we took it one step further too, by facial analysis that can tell you the best colors for you. This is actually a service that's in really high demand. Some people spend a lot of money getting their colors analyzed, and it's unaffordable for most consumers. So we baked this feature into NYX Beauty Bestie 2. You can instantly find out what color palette suits you best. You can find out, for example, that you should wear green when you get up and give your next talk. So every day, AI is making AR better and smarter. It's teaching AR how to understand the world around us and how to enhance the world around us. I was with my kid a couple days ago. She's two now. And she pointed at a rock in our yard and she said to me, "That's lichen, not moss." I was blown away. I guess somewhere along the way of all our walks in the woods and all our hikes outdoors, she's been listening and she's been learning. Well, our technologies are listening and learning too. What we put in is what we get out. So let's use AI and AR to make things that we're proud to raise up and proud to call our own. Thank you.